Hello, and thanks for joining us at the Bureau of Meteorology for a very special Facebook Live session. I'm Adam Morgan, I'm a meteorologist here at the Bureau of Meteorology National Operations Centre, which is behind us here. And I'm joined by Grace Legg. Hi, Grace.
Hey, Adam.
Thanks for joining us. Now, Grace, you're also a meteorologist here in the National Operations Centre as well, aren't you?
Yep, I work on the extreme weather desk down here.
So looking at all the types of high impact weather that affects Australia. Now, we're coming to the end of October and we're about to approach a very special date in the meteorological calendar in Australia, aren't we? So we're just about at cyclone season. So today, coming to the end of Cyclone Awareness Month around Australia, which is the month of October. So hopefully if you live in a cyclone-prone area of Australia, you've made all your preparations during the month of October. That's clearing your yard, tying down all loose items that might become airborne during a cyclone, doing all those necessary preparations. And as we come to the end of the month, we're here today to answer all your questions about tropical cyclones. Now, Grace, you've worked in Darwin, haven't you? You worked up there for a number of years, so you know a lot about tropical cyclones.
I do. I very much enjoy studying cyclones. So I've worked in the Darwin office and in the Tropical Cyclone Warning Centre there, and I actually helped out in one of the Brisbane activations as well.
Yeah, right. Now, I also worked in Darwin for a year. I didn't work on the cyclone desk, but I certainly was surrounded by all of our expert cyclone forecasters like Grace, so certainly got to know a lot about the inner workings of how cyclone forecasts are done. So hopefully I can help us out as well today. So for the next 10 or 15 minutes, we'd love you to ask all of your questions about cyclones. I'm going to throw the first one to you, Grace. And coming to the end of Cyclone Awareness Month and towards that very special date in the meteorological calendar, when do we see cyclones in the Australian region?
Well, we have our official start tomorrow, so 1st of November is the start of cyclone season, and then that continues all the way to the end of April. To be fair, cyclones are pretty rare in November. They do happen every now and then, but most of the bulk of our cyclones will be sort of end of December and into next year, generally where we see the monsoon hit as well. We do have had cyclones out of season, though. That has happened. We actually had a very famous one that happened pretty much on the 1st of July, just near the Solomon Islands. Very rare to happen, but can sometimes occur.
Yeah, where we see the cyclones during that cyclone season, so November to April, it's a little bit lumpy, isn't it? Really, it's often very slow to start. As Grace said, we really need that monsoon to arrive from the Northern Hemisphere. It kind of moves down across the equator and into Northern Australia. Once we get that really active monsoon activity, that's when we're more likely to see tropical cyclones form. And we kind of see the peak around February, March, really, isn't it? But it can happen any time. And then during the dry season months or the winter months, we're much less likely to see cyclones in Australia.
Yeah, it is very rare, as I said, just that one that formed to sort of throw us a little bit.
Now, where are the cyclone-prone regions in Australia, Grace? Where do we normally see cyclones most in Australia?
We see them more in the tropical regions. You need nice warm waters to get a cyclone going. So they're more likely to occur through those areas. So we have three areas that we look after. We've got WA's area, Northern Territory, and also the Queensland area. The area most likely to see it is actually the Western Australia area. It does extend quite far into the ocean, but it's also the most likely point you'll actually see landfall from a cyclone. So it's about Exmouth to Broome area has actually seen the most landfall of any cyclones.
So we need quite a bit of ocean water for cyclones to form, don't we? So there's a good reason why that northwest WA region is where we'd see quite a lot of cyclones form, or most likely in Australia. It's because there's a pretty vast body of water off the coast there. Cyclones can't form within a few degrees either side of the equator. So when you think about the northern coastline of Australia, just north of the top end there, there's actually not a huge body of water for cyclones to form. So we do see cyclones in that region, but not too often. And we see more in the Coral Sea and then even more off the northwest coast of Australia. And finally, Grace, my last one to you is, what are the basics of a tropical cyclone? What are the nuts and bolts of one?
Well, tropical cyclones defined is basically it's a low pressure system. To meet its category, it needs to be over warm waters, have that warm core of getting that energy, and it has to have gale force winds. So winds at least about 63 kilometres an hour wrapping halfway around the system. For them to form though, it's a pretty important environment. There's very things it needs. It needs that warm sea surface temperature to gain that energy from. It needs to have lots of moisture in it to allow thunderstorms to form near its core. And it also needs what's called little wind shear, so no change in wind speeds with depth to allow it to basically stack itself properly. So we can have those thunderstorms forming and allowing that pressure to go up and out, which allows that sort of low pressure system to continue to evolve.
Yeah, you can imagine, if any of you were watching our Ask Bomb Live a couple of weeks ago about severe thunderstorms, when I was talking with Dean Narramore, Dean was describing how wind shear, which is that change in direction or speed of wind with height in the atmosphere, can actually be a good thing for thunderstorms. For cyclones, it's not so good, because if you get stronger winds blowing aloft versus down below, it can kind of slice off the top. So we actually want very little wind shear in a cyclone situation, to, as Grace said, to allow that really good vertical stacking, that kind of air motion in, up and out at the top. So Grace, let's go to one from Alan. This goes back to where we get cyclones and don't get cyclones. So Alan asks, why do we not get cyclones in the south, say New South Wales? Thanks, Alan, for your question.
It's really just that it's not warm enough. You need seas level temperature of around 26.5 degrees through quite a depth to allow that energy to pull in and build. So if the cyclone starts moving into those colder air temperatures, it loses its warm core and its structure, in a sense, and it becomes extratropical, which is when you'll see, instead of having those strong winds near the center and that really tight gradient there, sort of spreads out a little more. You don't see as intense a winds, but you generally see them as a larger area because it no longer has that central core. It's just too cold for it to maintain.
And I guess that's a key difference between a tropical cyclone and a low pressure system that we might see more in the southern parts of Australia. I mean, they're both low pressure systems when it comes to the crunch, but tropical cyclones are what we call warm cored. They need the warm waters, the temperatures towards the middle of the low pressure systems are warmer than the outside, which is the reverse of low pressure systems that we see further to the south. So certainly the mechanisms that form tropical cyclones are just a fraction different to the types of low pressure systems that we'd normally see in, say, New South Wales. Okay, let's see this one from Cameron from Port Hedland. This is a really good place to be asking a question from. Cameron certainly would know a lot about tropical cyclones. He's right in that area that we talked about before on the northwest WA coast there. Cameron said, what's the next cyclone name? Do you know that one, Grace?
That one actually, I don't know. I know the
luckily
letter.
I do. Yeah.
I know the letter.
What letter are we up to, Grace?
I believe we're up to O.
We are up to O. So This actually leads us on to a really interesting topic. It's certainly the topic that I get asked most frequently about cyclones. How do cyclones get their names? But before we get there, I'll answer Cameron's question. The answer is Owen. So we're up to O and we're up to Owen. So it's a male name, this one, and we're up to Owen. So the next one will be P, and then that'll be a female name in this list. But essentially, how we name cyclones, we actually have five lists of names that go alphabetically from A to Z. And they cover all of our three tropical cyclone warning regions, Perth, Darwin, and Brisbane. And we generally just cycle through the names alphabetically from top to bottom, and then we restart from the first list again. So we finished off last season at N.
Nora.
Nora was the last one we finished last year in the Australian region, and then now we're up to O. So this one will be Owen. Now, Grace, when do we ever retire names, or what happens if we have a really notable tropical cyclone, like Cyclone Marsha or Cyclone Debbie or something like that?
That is when we choose to retire the name. So we're never going to have a Cyclone Debbie in our region again, or at least not named by us. Not going to have a Cyclone Tracy either, because they are such notable systems that carry a lot of sort of damage with them. They impacted a lot of people, so it matters a lot. So we don't really want that connotation on another system that may not actually cause any impact, might just be sitting over the ocean. We don't want people to sort of be concerned about that level of impact. We want them to treat each cyclone as their own system.
Certainly, and also it also aids to reduce confusion, so you're not getting one cyclone mixed up with a new one, or an old one mixed up with a new one. And also, if we get to a name on the list that might be a notable name of a politician or a notable figure in the community at the time, someone in the news, then we'll often skip that name and just move to the next one on the list. Now, you might have picked up in what Grace was saying a minute ago, there is one situation where we may not use a name from one of the Australian lists, and that's when a cyclone originates outside the Australian region. Can you give us an example of that, Grace? Can you think of any off the top of your head?
Yeah, it's Cyclone Yasi is the one that always springs to mind. So it started in the Fiji's region, so they named it. To avoid confusion, we don't rename it when it comes into our region. We just use the name that has already been given. So, you know, it's the same system that moves through. There's no confusion about if it's a different one that's formed.
Yeah, that's right. So Cyclone Yasi is a really good example. Okay, Grace, if If that question that we just talked about was the number one question I get asked, this is probably the number two question I get asked. Are cyclones, this is from Ingrid, so thanks Ingrid, are cyclones exactly the same as typhoons and hurricanes? I know this is your pet topic.
This
Grace.
Is my pet topic, it comes up a lot. They are exactly the same in the way that they're formed in the systems they are. There's just slight difference to what we call them. So we always call ours a tropical cyclone. From a category 3 and above, we call them a severe tropical cyclone. The other regions, such as America, uses hurricane, or Japan that uses typhoon. For what would be their category 1 and 2, they actually call them tropical storms. Mm. And then from category 3 and above, they'll be named typhoon or hurricane. But they're all exactly the same systems. The only real difference is in the northern hemisphere, they spin the opposite way.
That's right. So the only difference is in the direction in which the winds go. But typhoons, hurricanes, cyclones, they're all the same thing. But tornadoes and cyclones are very different things, and that's often the question I get asked as well. So they're different, but yeah, certainly typhoons, hurricanes and cyclones are certainly all the same thing. Okay, so this is going a little bit more in detail, perhaps when we were talking about the systems off New South Wales, things like that. So this is a question from Josh. So Josh asks, with weather events such as the East Coast lows that have wreaked havoc across Queensland, Victoria and New South Wales, what does it actually take to be classified as a cyclone? And how far south have we seen, or should we expect to see cyclones in the future?
The future's a bit of a hard one, but yeah, they have to be warm cords, so they need those warm temperatures. So you're normally looking at Brisbane, the Northern Territory and WA are really the only places that we'll see them.
It's really about where those really warm ocean temperatures are, and where you've got to think about where are we more likely to see those ocean temperatures around 26.5 degrees or above, and it really is in the tropical regions of the world.
That being said, at the moment, we only see them in those regions, but if you go up to like Japan can see their typhoons up any of their coast, and it's just that their temperatures are warmer further north, so that's why they're able to see them. For us, it's just going to have to be those regions that are going to see it, and to classify it, as I said, needs that warm core, getting that energy warmer in the center, and it needs those gale force winds around at least half of the system for at least 6 hours as well.
Yeah, so there is a very technical definition there of when we would name a cyclone. It's based on how long the winds have blown and how far around the center we do see those gale force winds, and then how we escalate through the categories beyond that is according to specific intervals of wind speeds, isn't it, Grace?
So it's all about the maximum wind around the center for what category it'll get to. So you're going from gale, storm force, and then hurricane force winds. So that's what they need around the center to continue up that classification. Doesn't take into account any other impacts. Mm. We're only looking at the maximum winds for the categories that we give them.
And certainly the higher the category is a really good indication of the, the escalation of the types of impacts that you could expect with a tropical cyclone. And certainly category 1 and category 2, we call them tropical cyclones, and then category 3, 4 and 5, that's when we add the name severe to the front, so it becomes severe tropical cyclones in the Australian region. Okay, so this is a good one from Jasmine, actually. It's a little bit tricky. So the Atlantic Basin name subtropical storms, why doesn't the BOM name East Coast lows? That's a very good question.
It is a good question.
The
New South Wales office have a very actually strict definition
of
what is an East Coast low. It's actually like, it's almost as strict as a definition for a tropical cyclone. But there, it hasn't been quite as much done to exactly when you would name the system that. So it's a lot more at sort of where it forms and its exact impacts, and less than just the base meteorology. So because we probably don't have a strict definition, it's a bit harder to name them and sort of move on. Also, they may not last as long.
That's what I was going to go with. I reckon the storms that we can name, names are useful when we can track the one system that lasts for a long time. East Coast lows are often quite transient, only around for a day or two. They don't last too long. They might form on the spot and then kind of dissipate where they are. They may track longer. You know, I think one of the more significant ones we had 2 or 3 years ago in New South Wales actually tracked all the way kind of almost down the Queensland coast in towards Sydney, and then all the way down to towards Tasmania. That was the one where we had swimming pools kind of washing off people's backyards there along the foreshore in Sydney there. But I'm thinking of other areas of the world, and I know that the UK Met Office, for example, just a few years ago began to name deep low pressure systems in the North Atlantic Ocean, similarly to the way that we and the US National Weather Service name tropical cyclones. They do it for low pressure systems. There's no reason we couldn't do that. It's just that we don't do that by tradition, and certainly probably it's that longevity of systems, I think, that probably comes into it a little bit.
It's also, you're not going to get more than one east coast low at a time, so it's not really confusing about which system we're talking about, whereas you can have more than one cyclone, so we want to be able to make sure there's no mix up with those systems.
Yes, thank you. Now, Helena has a good question. Can you have cyclones heading towards each other?
You can, actually. There's a very interesting effect that happens when cyclones get near each other, which is called the Fujiwara effect. And it basically is they actually interact with each other and spin around each other, which is very interesting.
Kind of like doing a spiral sort of dance around each other. So two cyclones independently spiraling and then spiraling around each other.
Yeah, so it's quite an interesting one. So they can move towards each other. They might have different upper systems that are pulling them that way, and then they'll actually interact. So they normally won't hit each other, but they'll often go around each other. So it's quite an interesting effect, to almost end up at opposite ends that they started with.
That's right. Now, and there's also the situations where we can have cyclones forming on opposite sides of the equator. So there's a certain type of wave in the atmosphere. And when I talk about waves, you think about waves on the ocean. Well, the atmosphere is a fluid. It's air. It's like water in the sense that it's a fluid. And we can have waves that progress through the atmosphere. You can't see them with your eyes, but what we can see on satellite is the effect of these waves, and one of those effects for waves that move from the east to the west along the equator in the tropics is a Kelvin wave. And sometimes when we see that, we see cyclones form exactly in the same location, but on opposite sides of the equator, and kind of move in sync with each other, don't we?
Yeah, we've seen two forms. So they're spinning the opposite ways. They look quite interesting on either side of the equator, and they'll almost move together along that wave.
If you track them on satellite imagery, you can kind of see them just moving in parallel on opposite sides of the equator. Let's move to the next one now. Ooh, that's a good one. It's a bit tricky, and I don't know if I have the answer to this. So Brian asks, why are there different scales used to measure cyclones and hurricanes between the USA and Australia, and why not have a global standard? Now, I don't know why we don't have a global standard.
We technically do. The World Met Organization has given us the categories in which we jump, so we go from category 1 to 2, and the other regions actually do have, at least Japan does and Fiji do. America has technically the same scale for jumping, but there's a slight difference with the way they do it.
That's right.
Yeah. And it's how they measure the mean winds. So it's always based on those sustained winds, not the gusts. And the sustained winds are 1 minute averages for the US and 10 minute averages for us.
Yeah, so we just measure the wind speed slightly in a different way. So that probably equates for some of the differences between scales. But the naming, we just name them differently in each part of the world, don't we? Now, Grace, I've just been given the wind-up, so I think I've lost track of time here. So we've had lots of fun answering all your questions about cyclones today. So don't forget, as we come to the end of Cyclone Awareness Month in October, if you do live in the cyclone-prone parts of Australia, so across the northern parts of Western Australia, Northern Territory and Queensland, make sure you do use this opportunity to make all your cyclone preparations before the season starts. Make sure you have your cyclone kit together and know what you'll do when a cyclone hits, if it hits near you, because it only takes one cyclone to make impact near where you are for it to be a bad cyclone season. And make sure you stay in touch with emergency services and the bomb all throughout cyclone season for all the latest forecast warnings and information. So thanks for joining me, Grace.
Thanks for having me.
And we'll join you very soon for another Ask Bomb Live.